Alrighty, good morning to you. 6 minutes after 9 o'clock. This is the Mighty 1190 WIXC. We are glad y'all are with us. Thank you for tuning in to the Talk of the Town segment right here on the Mighty 1190 WIXC. Fortunate to have our congressman with us today, Robert Pittenger. How you doing, Congressman?
Good morning. Always good to be with you guys.
Well, we're glad to have you here in Union County and in Monroe. And we were talking a little bit before the show got started. And actually, four people in Union County, you keep an office here a couple of days a week. I mean, if folks have questions, concerns, issues, you're easy to get a hold of here in Union County.
Yes, sir. Every Tuesday and Wednesday. We spend half a day in Waxhaw, Weddington, Stallings, or Indian Trail. And love for people to call in and talk to us, 704-365-6234. And we'll be glad to respond to any needs they've got.
You know, it's amazing to me. We talk about this a lot, whether it's a county commission election or a school board or a Congress. A lot of times, congressmen don't know how to help if people who vote for them don't tell them what their issues and concerns are. And I'm sure you get plenty of calls. Don't get me wrong. But I've always been an advocate for if people would do just a tiny bit of homework on stuff and start paying attention to what was going on, they could learn a lot more and ask a lot better questions. A lot of people just kind of throw darts and hope that they ask something that'll stick. Everybody's got a question and a concern, and everybody's got something they want to know about. And I know you guys are super busy. You were telling us before we started, you have a lot to do with, you said it was an intelligence or Middle East?
Yes, sir. I chair a congressional task force on terrorism and unconventional warfare. And certainly each of us are...
That's been a hot button.
Well, it very much so. The issues that we're facing over there are the gravest that, frankly, we've ever had.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, it's caught the attention of the Germans and the French, who were very reluctant and did not get involved in the Iraq War. Mm-hmm. But as such, they are fully committed to this whole concern with this ISIS, this new Iraqi state that's developed of terrorists. We have got to focus on them. They are a real threat to our national security and our freedoms.
Congressman, can we affect a change in that region without boots on the ground?
Well, I think the boots on the ground need to be regional boots. I think they need to be our friends and our partners over there.
Do we have a playing partner right now over there in this conflict with ISIS?
Yes. We've got to do more to develop those relationships. And frankly, the administration hasn't done a really good job of fulfilling that, need.
We were told there's no strategy to this.
Well, regrettably, it's been no strategy since he got to town. We have dropped the ball initially on all the problems related to Syria. We didn't back the Free Syrian Army. We got fully disengaged. And that's frankly why this new ISIS group, this Islamic State, emerged. The president has not wanted to be involved. He didn't back the Kurds. He didn't back the Iraqi army. And so now we're confronted with a group of about 10,000 barbaric terrorists. They chop little kids to pieces.
Yeah.
But just because they're Christian, they will chopped off heads of reporters, of course.
Yeah.
But they are fully committed to flying their flag above the White House. And
yeah,
the tragedy of it right now is they've got passports. They have American passports. They have European passports. And that makes them distinctive from other terrorist groups.
They have the weaponry, and then they have the funding. Where are they getting their funding from?
Well, they've gotten funding from sympathetic individuals. Now they get their funding off their threats and intimidations and robbing banks and hostages.
Because I know what our policy is, but we've read several stories about, I think, the Spanish and the French have paid ransoms to get people back. Not anything in the market of $100 million, but a couple of $1 million is it's no different in a lot of ways than the Somali pirates
year they've gotten as much as $200 million.
Mm-hmm. And I know that's not our policy, but you got to know that money's going to fund what they're doing. I mean, it's just that simple.
Well, people, they extort.
Yeah.
They're very effective in doing that. They extort businesses over there. They'll go to, we'll protect you. We'll protect the Christians. Give me some money.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how they've been able to successfully fund their interests to date. However, they're sitting on the largest, richest all fields in the world.
Well, I think a lot of people are upset about it and don't know all the facts. It's not that there hasn't been work done on this front. The problem with it has been there's been a lot of work done. There's been a lot of bills submitted, and they don't seem to get past, well, quite frankly, Harry Reid, just to be honest with you. He loves to just tell everybody what he's going to do before he reads anything.
Well, the president has
anything.
A history of bypassing
yes.
Congress, and it's got to be frustrating to people like you where that's your job and you're not allowed to do it. By executive order, we're doing this and doing that without the way our forefathers set up how it's supposed to be, where this thing is these things are voted on.
Well, the crisis that we're facing today in the border is a result of his executive orders.
Yeah.
We wouldn't be where we are today with this enormous influx of individuals from Central America. But he created that opportunity and allowed young people to come over here to bypass our judicial system. He's used executive orders. Frankly, he's been shot down now 12 times by the Supreme Court. We have filed a lawsuit. The Speaker has, and the House yeah. supported that with a resolution dealing with the health care program.
I want to get back to that. I want to ask you about these, I don't know what the latest count, it was like 62,000 children from Honduras and different areas mm-hmm. that are coming in. Do we have an open door policy? Where does this stand? I think there was a governor, I want to say of Utah, whatever, that some arrived by plane and he chartered a plane to send them back to Honduras. I mean, where do we stand on this issue right now with all these children coming?
Well, the likely will be upwards to 100,000 by the end of this year with the present surge of them. And again, this is allowed because of an open door policy that the president has created. The House passed legislation before we left in August. This legislation would seal the border, would secure the border, funding the National Guard. Governor Perry from Texas has already committed the National Guard, but this would fund the National Guard throughout our borders with Mexico. As well, it would process these young children in a more timely way, not allow this exploitation of a previous law passed in 2008 for trafficking that's been utilized to keep them here and take care of them humanitarily and, you know, their physical needs, and then get them shipped back to their own countries. That's essentially what our bill did. It's now been sent to the Senate. They left town. They didn't do anything about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I mean, they did. The problem is a lot of these kids can't even tell you where they came from. They're so young. I mean, what a problem that is. We turn them around and send them back, and they're not traveling with their parents.
They have enormous health needs.
Yes.
Imagine these kids going to our schools.
We had it worse than that. It used to be when they were coming across, you tried to sneak and get past the Border Patrol. I saw a report a couple of weeks ago said now the coyotes are calling the Border Patrol. They're calling, say, all right, there's 60 of them coming. Y'all might want to hang around. It's a business is all it is. And people don't realize that it's a business. These people, they get paid thousands of dollars to get them to the border and get them across. And we always assume that they don't have newspapers or televisions down there, and they do. They're watching this. They're seeing it. They're seeing that, hey, if we can just get there, they'll let you in, and it's just going to get worse. It's not going to get better.
Once we start shipping them back,
yes.
It'll stop. And that's what our bill does, the last in or the first out. We're committed to the only way we can stop this is, number one, secure our borders.
Mm-hmm.
We can't have an immigration policy without securing the borders, and that's the first and foremost thing on our minds. And then we need to start shipping these kids back and to their countries, or else we're going to be talking about millions, not hundreds of thousands.
Yeah.
Congressman Robert Pinger is our special guest. How sad, though, from a parental standpoint, where you feel like your child is safer by
yeah.
giving them to a stranger to try to get to the border than rather to raise them in the environment that they're in with the gangs. And
countless numbers die in the process or
yeah.
physically sexually exploited and abused on the way here.
Yeah, terrible.
So it's a travesty of every concern. And
where are we with immigration reform?
Well, again, the only true immigration reform that we need to address right now is sealing our border. We've got to secure a border.
Mm-hmm.
We cannot allow that to continue. There cannot be any discussion of immigration reform. You certainly cannot trust the president. He wants this big package of total reform, and that's a non-starter. The president hasn't been trusted with the Health Care Act. He's changed the act on his own free will. In fact, that's why we're challenging him in the courts today. He changed the mandates on and rescinded some and twisted and changed others, and so he rewrote the law. But we're not going to have a total comprehensive plan on immigration. What we need right now is a plan to secure the border. Then there can be a discussion after that on what's the best thing for America regarding the 11 million people who are here in this country today.
You know, the argument can be made that America is a land of immigrants and a land founded by immigrants, and in a lot of ways it is, but people tend to forget there's also a process to go through. We've never had a closed door policy. People can and have always been able to come here. Who I feel sorry for are the people who are going about it the right way. The people who have filed the paperwork, and the people who are waiting their turn, and the people who are learning and doing what they need. Think about that. I mean, they're going through the process and 30 people are passing them just coming in. It's not right.
I spoke Friday to a naturalization ceremony in our federal court in Charlotte. I've done this several times now, of people who have gone through the immigration process. They were there from about, I'd say, 20 countries, approximately, I think 48 people went through naturalization. And I went there to honor and pay respect to them, because they respected our
absolutely
law.
Listen, they talk like it's pretty tough.
Couldn't pass it, probably.
Yeah, it's a pretty good history exam from what I understand.
Yeah. Well, it was very impressive. It's very heartwarming, very moving for all of us.
Yeah.
They are emotional. I'm emotional. The judge is. It's a very touching ceremony, because they are so respectful of the opportunity to come to America. You know, that's what America is. America, we cherish, and all who have come to this country cherish it because of one word. It's called opportunity. That's what brought our forefathers each to come here. And we need to respect the rule of law. Those individuals who are coming here are able, they want to come because we are a foundation of a country built on the rule of law. We have private property, a freedom of speech. People can take their energy, their resources, their abilities, and build something and create. We've created the jobs. We become the envy of the world. And so we need to make sure that that stays in place. And you continue that process by making sure that we're a country of laws and we enforce those laws. So none of these individuals, frankly, who went through our naturalization process, that ceremony, none of them would support an illegal immigration effort. They understand and respect the rule of law. So we've got to begin with that.
Speaking of the rule of law, I think that's what has gotten the president in some hot water, and now he faces a lawsuit. Explain this lawsuit against the president. This has got nothing, I've heard you say, it's got nothing to do with impeachment.
No,
explain what the lawsuit is, and where do you expect it to go?
It's good that you brought that up regarding impeachment. Impeachment certainly are options. President Clinton was impeached. He continued to do what he wanted to do in the continuation of his presidency. We've chosen the path of this lawsuit because there is strong basis legally to secure a victory in the lawsuit. The president has avoided the fulfillment of the entire law. He's chosen to, on his own volition, to change parts of the mandate to the healthcare law, and he doesn't have the right to do that. The law was passed in the Congress. Where does the president have arbitrarily the right to go back and change a portion of that law?
Mm-hmm.
This is not, he's one part of our government. He's one branch. He's not the whole branch. I wrote an editorial not too long ago called "The Man Who Would Be King."
I think I saw part of that.
Well, yes. CNN published it, but, you know, he's not king. He's not monarch. I think he wished he was. He has disdain for the Congress. He doesn't want to put up with us, and yet he has to constitutionally. So this is about the Constitution. This is not about, I don't like the president or I don't like his policies. No, the purpose of this lawsuit is to make sure that we are a constitutional government. We have an executive branch. We have a legislative branch. We have a judicial branch. They're all equal branches. He's not a superior branch. Mm-hmm. We don't report to the president. He thinks that we report to him. That's not the case. We worked in conjunction with the president.
Well, how far do you think that lawsuit will go?
It could go to the Supreme Court.
While he's in office? I mean, the wheels turn off.
The wheels turn slow. You're exactly right, but they're going to turn. And we're committed to this. Speaker Boehner is not one who just throws rocks.
Yeah.
He believes that, and we believe that we have a strong basis. I've met with the attorneys myself and heard what they are going to present, and it's sound. It's very logical. And frankly, you can't go change something indiscriminately on your own part that was passed by the U.S. Congress.
Well, you know what's scary about it is, and I mentioned this on the program, you can take whether something's legal or illegal. And if somebody tells you to do it and you do it, it becomes legal by default just because they did it. I remember when the mandate came down about, he told the insurance companies, hey, y'all, I changed my mind. Go ahead and let people keep their plan another year. Mm-hmm. And my first thought was, don't do it. It's not, but they did it. And by doing it, it's almost like he's smart enough to realize that if you tell somebody to do something and they do it, then by default, it becomes legal, and he figures nobody's going to take him to court over it. So I'm glad. I mean, if the court system says it's legal and he did, that's fine. But I want to hear it from somebody with the authority to make the decision.
Executive orders were put there by our founding fathers for a limited scope. We didn't have air travel then where we could come back. But when they left and were gone, or not in session, this is their own horseback.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, if there had to be a critical decision made regarding an appointment or not full range of policy, not passing legislation, not impacting what's going to have in the future healthcare system. No, if there's some type of appointment or something that need to be made, then yes, the president could do that. It would be time costly or preventative to wait for Congress to reconvene just for that one appointment. So that was the purpose of it. And now that has been taken far beyond what any president has ever done. He has taken the executive orders into policy. What is done in the past is more related to appointments and making appointments of certain positions outside of the natural order of governing. But he's even been reined in on some of his appointments. The NLRB board, the National Labor Relations Board. He got called back by the Supreme Court because of making that appointment outside of the
I know the congressman has got a few more minutes. He can be with us. So if it's okay, let's go ahead and take our break so we can come back and finish up because you can stay here from what Jamie was telling me for another 20 minutes and talk with us.
We can, and I've got Linda Furster here with me. She's our Constituent Services Director.
Good deal.
She is in the county every week. And it was available to respond to any concerns that people have and individually or personally with the government. We've got a convoluted, messed up government, and we're going to help you work through it.
Let's take a quick break, come back, and continue our conversation. Y'all stick around just a moment.
Hi, this is Dr. Terry Moffitt, and now your Talk of the Town weather brought to you by Central Academy at Lake Park.
All right, folks, 95 degrees today. If you liked yesterday, you'll probably love today. Overnight 73 for tomorrow, 92, still hot and humid outside, 88 Thursday, 88 Friday. So a little cooler by the end of the week. And then over the weekend, 90 for Saturday, 85 Sunday. Pretty good chances of thunderstorms every day this week as well. It's 80 degrees and clear outside at the studios of Wixie.
Hi, I'm Dr. Terry Moffitt, the head of school at Central Academy at Lake Park. Central Academy at Lake Park is an accredited K-12 school that exists to equip each child to reflect Christ and pursue a distinct life and vocation in response to God's calling. Our purpose is to provide academic excellence based upon biblical principles and values. We educate students in the fullness of God's truth in every aspect and facet of student life. Schedule a tour today by calling 704-882-6267 or visit us at calpnc.org.
This is Lenny with another Lenny's Life Lessons. Listen, if you ever suspect someone's following you in your camper, take four right turns. That makes a circle. If they're still behind you, they following you.
Fall will be here before you know it, and it's time to go camping from Country Camping Corner. The 2015s are coming in, and there's special pricing on those 2014s. New pop-ups, $49.95. Used pop-ups, $29.95. Go to countrycamping.com or call them at 704-882-1173.
Monroe Transmission wants you to recognize the warning signs of transmission problems before it's too late. If your car refuses to go into gear or slips, leaking fluid, check engine light, grinding or shaking, it's time to let Monroe Transmission check it out today. Call them at 704-289-2268.
At Interstate All Batteries, we have cell phone, laptop, camcorder, watch, four-wheeler, golf cart, boat, power wheelchairs. Let's just say we have every battery you will ever need. And if we don't have it, we can get it. Interstate All Batteries, 704-289-8166, or come by and see us across from Crossroads Ford on Highway 74.
All right, welcome back. It's about 28 minutes after the hour of 9 o'clock. This is the Mighty 1190. Congressman Robert Pittenger joins us this morning. We really appreciate him taking time to come in and be with us. He told us before the break that Linda Furster was with him, and Linda would be the lady that you would contact if you had any concerns or questions or anything here in the county. She would be the your contact person, and I guess you hear from quite a few people, Linda.
Well, we're trying to get the word out of our new office hours, and we're making an attempt to make it convenient for our constituents in Union County to serve them. We're in Waxhaw and Stallings every Tuesday. We're in Weddington and Indian Trail every Wednesday. And I want to clear up one thing I've heard from some people, because we put out mailings and e-blast and all that to get the word out. This is not just because it's the district work period. This is a permanent situation. The congressman is trying to make it convenient for our constituents in Union County and not to have to make a trip to Charlotte to the office if they want to come in and
see
us.
Good deal.
Linda is the constituent services representative. So if you have any question, like Congressman said, a lot of bureaucracy, red tape, you know, with our government. But if you're having issues, questions, concerns about Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, veteran benefits, your passport, you know, IRS matters, you're the liaison that can then cut through some of this stuff for these people.
And yes, sir. And I can get you, get them to the right person on staff. In our office, we specialize. We have caseworkers that specialize on, like one caseworker does just Social Security and Medicare.
You know, that's half the battle, knowing who to talk to.
That's right. And you know, there are things we can, if it's federal, we can assist. If it's state and local, we cannot intervene, but we can certainly help point them in the right direction and give them the contact of who to speak with.
That's great. And from what I understand, these are this permanent office, this is not, you know, it used to be a lot of times with our politicians, they'd have a temporary office set up in an empty built, you know, for a month or two or whatever. This is a permanent location in Waxhaw, Stallings, Weddington, and Indian Trail, permanent offices.
Yes, the towns have been very gracious to us to give us a meeting place so that we can be available for people to come in, and if they want to come in and talk to us, or they can call and speak with us by phone.
So, Linda, someone's having a, you know, a request. They want to find out about, say, a military academy nomination, which go through your office. What's the best way to reach you with these questions about Social Security or what have you?
Well, the best way is to call our Charlotte office at 704-362-1060.
Okay.
And they would be directed to the person on staff that handles that issue. Bob Becker is the one who handles all veteran and military issues. If they speak with me, I'm going to get them to Bob or get him the information to contact them.
Okay, very good.
Thank you,
Linda.
You know, before we get back to talking, I want to ask you one thing, Congressman. I don't know how much this is a matter. One of the things I've noticed here recently with everything going on is a lot of people in the president's own party have started to change a little bit of what they say with the midterm elections coming up. I wonder does, and I hate for you to speak on his behalf, but I wonder, does he not realize this isn't going to help? You know what I mean? There are a lot of things going on now, and that does not show good unity. It doesn't matter which party you belong to when they start saying, nah, I'm out, you know, not me. I ain't got anything to do with this. And you're seeing more of that now.
Absolutely. There's a real disconnect. It really seems to me, by the president, his policies, and the reality of the world that we live in. The Democrats, they understand that as well. And they don't really want to be next to the president, particularly in a year that's an important political year mm-hmm. for him to keep the Senate and for us to keep the House. If there's a transition in who owns and controls the Senate, then that will greatly affect the last 2 years of his presidency. So the president's out there. He is the president of campaigning. He's a student of campaigning. But he has a very specific agenda. He does not want to be engaged in the realities of the world. We had a man named Chamberlain years ago who didn't understand the realities of Adolf Hitler and preceded what occurred there in England. And, you know, the president needs to understand that what we face today is a major threat to our national security. Other world leaders see that today, those who are very removed from what our operations were and activities in Iraq understand this threat. The Democrat leaders who are running for office, they hear the people, they understand the concerns, but the president has not wanted to lead. And he has just kind of put his head in the sand in the wake of reality that's there.
What's been noticeable is some of the what's been called the mainstream media is starting to even now to question the president's timing. I mean, this whole thing with ISIS and mm-hmm. You know, some of the brutal stuff. Within minutes of addressing the nation about it, the president's back on the golf
course. Yeah, what was it? 12:57, he was talking about the beheading, and 106, he was swinging a club. It was like 9 minutes.
Just
grinning, going down the course in his golf cart.
That's just horrible.
It just doesn't
timing.
Look good.
No.
The optics of that are terrible.
You've been quoted as saying, I would never boycott Burger King. They do have a pretty good sandwich.
Sure.
But you said we should be driven by competitive markets. Shame on us for having the highest corporate tax rate in the world.
That's what I said. When did Canada become a tax haven?
We cannot blame a company for trying to expand their markets and trying to compete. And in all fairness to Burger King, there are plenty of other companies that have moved their headquarters offshore so they can avoid, I think, I know Apple, GE, I mean, there's a lot of them, and billions of dollars. If they bring this money into this country, of course, they have to pay tax on it, and they're not doing that. But you blame the tax code.
I blame our policies.
Yeah.
You know, what has occurred, frankly, in the first 2 years of President Obama's presidency was the passage of an inordinate amount of new regulations and heavy tax burden, and then, of course, the Obamacare. Place a huge burden on small and large business. Now, you know, if a corporation is paying the highest corporate rate in the entire industrialized world, it just makes sense to them. They're trying to find breathing room. Mm-hmm. They're trying to survive in a very competitive world market, and in the midst of all these enormous new regulatory environment and new healthcare obligations, they're saying, where can we continue to exist and find room? So, I mean, it's real simple. Cut our tax rates. Be more competitive. You know, we had a problem in North Carolina when I was in the state Senate. We are the highest corporate and individual tax rate of any state in the Southeast. And companies were bypassing North Carolina. We're losing by default.
Mm-hmm.
They were going to South Carolina, just across the border.
They're
going to
plants.
Tennessee, yep. Going to Florida. They're going wherever to avoid North Carolina.
Just not here.
Yeah. You know, but why would they want to go where they're paying the highest corporate and marginal individual tax rates? It's no different than a corporation. The corporation is going somewhere else to avoid that heavy burden.
Yep.
They need to exist. They need to compete. So we've got to be responsive to that. Shame on us. Shame on the president. You know, they have this insatiable need for revenue, and they want to build a bigger government, have more control over people's lives. They want to regulate, they want to manage, they want to centralize planned government, and it costs money. And so they look for every source to bring in more revenue. We couldn't even reform the tax code, revenue neutral. And there was a plan there, a plan that was written by Max Baucus, who was the banking chairman in the Senate, a Democrat, and Dave Camp, who was the House chairman of Ways and Means in the House, a Republican. They had a plan. It was a good plan. It wasn't perfect, but it was good. It lowered the tax code for everybody, every citizen, every business. And what happened? Along came Harry Reid, and along came Barack Obama. They said, no, we need another $1 trillion in revenue. You can't reform your tax code revenue neutral. That makes sense. These people, they have an insatiable need for more revenue, more taxes to build a bigger government. Well, we didn't become a great country because of a great government. We became a great country because of people, individual, freedom, the opportunity to go out there and to build something, to create jobs. A government only gets in the way. Now we have an overpowered in government in our lives, and we need to reduce the role of government. That's what Ronald Reagan did back in the 80s. Ronald Reagan cut the tax burden, he cut the regulatory burden, and the economy took off. Mm-hmm. We were creating 300, 400, 500,000 jobs a month, 1 month, a million jobs. Today, we're supposed to clap if they get up to 200,000 jobs.
Mm-hmm.
We had an economy that was growing at 6%. Now we're barely eking at it 2%. Why? Because we have this taxing, over-regulatory government, and we've got to go back to freedom, free markets, empower the individual, get government out of the way. And that's where we can return, and that's what we're committed to do. The House of Representatives, frankly, has been the only firewall against what the president's tried to do. They've had the Senate and Harry Reid do nothing. Even when I passed the Kyle Davenport bill, here's a bill to help, you know, children, you know, child abuse. And, you know, we got it passed in the House, wasn't a problem. Sent it to the Senate. It sat in committee for 7 months in judicial committee. And I made a phone call over there and I said, can we just get together on child abuse?
Yeah. If there's one thing.
Yeah. Like there's nothing political in that.
That you know, you would think people can work together on. It's
child abuse. Well, finally, that afternoon, amazingly enough, I got a call back from Harry Reid. And Senator Reid said, Congressman, you know, I know about your bill. I know what it's all about. He said, you know, if it gets out of committee, I'm gonna support it on the floor. But I'll tell you, we're not doing much over here.
Yeah, well,
I didn't know whether to laugh or to cry because they're not. We've sent 350-plus bills. The pass in the House, these are good bills. We have 40 bills on job training that will help people equip them to get a new and better job. There's 20 million people today without a job, without a good job. And we passed good bipartisan job training bills he won't even take up in the Senate.
Because it's got the wrong person's name on it.
It came out of the House. They just didn't want to take any votes. But he took our vote. We made it happen. And God bless the Davenport family.
Yeah.
We got that bill passed. It's been signed by the president. In fact, we had a little reception for the Davenport family a couple weeks ago. Mm-hmm. Just to honor them and the work that they did. And we had the privilege of carrying the ball up there in Congress. And but as a tribute to them for this sweet little girl whose life was taken. So we can work together. We've got but we need a leadership in the Senate who will be responsive. Harry Reid's not responsive. I'm a Republican. I hope we take a Republican Senate. We'll get a lot more done for the good of the American people.
I also want to ask you, too, a little closer to home, as is the Kyle Davenport bill, but you arranged a meeting with Garland Denny, a friend of the station.
Oh yeah, I know Garland.
A man that is, if nothing else, this man is committed to what he wants to do. And you arranged a meeting with the president.
I did. Well,
explain that. That's awesome.
I had the invitation.
I know Garland had his book with him too, didn't he?
Sure. I had an invitation to be the president. I thought this didn't make sense. Let's get Garland with the president. I don't need to be the president. And Garland has had a commitment. I mean, here's what, 83 years old.
Yes.
He's a sweet man, but he wants to help veterans, period.
A true patriot.
He is wonderful. And he had an idea of really out of the box of having a postage stamp and doing some stuff. And so we're pushing this thing along. Well, you know, we've got the White House backing it now. And we've been to the Postal Service, and they can't get involved in terms of congressional support, but they said they would go along with it.
Yeah.
So who knows?
This goes to show if you keep trying.
That's right.
Keep trying.
He will talk to anybody that will
yes,
listen.
Sir. Yeah. It don't make any difference. If he walked in that door right now, he'd walk right in here and start talking.
Well, we take him seriously. And Frank, his idea is a great idea, and we're committed to it, and we're going to see this thing through. I'm going to work my tail off to make sure we get this stamp approved and help veterans. That's what he wants to do, is raise money to help our dear veterans who have been out there and given their their life and their blood.
Let's face it, the VA's took some lumps over the last few months, and it's not been any fault of the veteran. It's been stuff that was going on in the administratively in the VA system, and you take that, and then what happened over at the IRS with Lois Lerner and Benghazi and several other things, and I'm just going to be honest with you, there's a lack of trust, I think, on the part of the American people that there hadn't been in a long, long time.
Yeah, I
just think people don't have any trust.
They don't trust in government, period. I mean, look at what's happened to the IRS. Look at the Attorney General. No matter where you go, the role of government has been invasive.
And untruthful.
They've exploited people. It's been terrible.
We've hacked the German Chancellor's phone. I mean, we're not trustworthy.
And don't think they haven't tried to hack ours, too. Okay? Yeah.
So you're convinced that goes both ways.
Well, that's just the way intelligence is. Frankly, I'm hosting a briefing this month in Washington. Is my role as chairman of the Congressional Task Force on Terrorism. And we have 100 members of parliament coming over from 20 European countries. And we've got to work together. The enemies, our adversaries, they want us divided. There is a fracture that's come up out of all the Snowden revelations. And frankly, there's a lot of misinformation out there of what we're doing and what we're not doing. We are not reading people's emails and phone numbers unless we get a court order. And that court order says that there has been a call or an email from a known terrorist to someone in the United States. We want to know what that's about. That's what this is about. I had 5 members of parliament come over from Austria 2 months ago just to talk. One of them was a member of the Green Party, as vice chair of the Intel Committee. He wrote back the most wonderful letter saying, thank you for being so transparent, so open. We need this relationship. America is important for the future security of the world, and we stand with you. And it was very positive. So we want this to continue, this dialogue. We have the chairmen of Intel Committee, Homeland Security, the NSA, everyone who's involved on our side, who'll be meeting with them to help them understand better what our process is and how we're there to protect privacy, but we're there to also to secure this country, which is the constitutional requirement that we have as members of Congress, that we will protect this country from our adversaries from within and from without.
I want to remind our listeners, you do have several, you've been doing these town hall meetings, which has been great. You have 3 this week. Let's see, tonight at 6:30, you'll be out at in the Ballantyne area.
Yes, sir. St. Martin's Catholic Church. St. Matthew's Catholic Church.
Yeah, that's at 6:30 tonight.
Yep.
Then tomorrow night, 6:30, out in Matthews Town Hall. And then you'll be in Waxhaw on Thursday night, 6:30, out at Cuthbertson High School.
Yes, sir.
What are you hearing from? What kind of feedback are you getting from these town hall meetings?
People are frustrated with the government. They see an invasive government. They want to know what we can do to cut back on Obamacare or prevent it or stop it, replace it. They're concerned, yes, about our national security. Why is the president leading? Why has he put his head in the sand? They're concerned about immigration, greatly concerned about immigration. What's happened with this influx of tens of thousands of young people coming across our borders? When are we ever going to secure our borders? They'll hear a lot about that. And, of course, we want to take their questions. If they've got concerns, as you said a little while ago, about Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, the IRS, we're here to help them. Half of my job is just helping constituents with concerns that they have. So they go to pittenger.house.gov or call us at 704-362-1060 in any way we can help them. But we sure hope that they can come out to one of these town halls this week.
Well, and I speak for a lot of people when I thank you for doing these and making yourself available. Sure. A lot of people are saying, I'm so fed up with this or that or that. And it's like, well, you need to talk to your congressman. Well, how do I do that? Well, simple. You go to a town hall meeting that's in your backyard.
Or just call.
And you tell your congressman how you feel about it, or you call.
I don't have an opponent this year in the election. I want to hear, though, from my constituents. I want to meet with them. I'm there to serve them. We are public servants, and my desire is to serve our constituents.
I know you got to get out of here. They told me you were pressed for time, but that's the thing about it. A lot of times when you're running for re-election, you have to devote so much time to campaigning. It's kind of nice to not have to necessarily campaign and just go out and talk to people. And I think that's what's lacking now, is there's just not enough talking. It's all Well, it's like the president. He's still campaigning. He can't even run again. He's campaigning to the last day of office.
Well, please come out. We want to hear the concerns of our constituents. We want to respond to any personal need they have, and we want to get their ideas and where we need to go forward.
And for the love of God, vote for everything we, you know, for all the complaints we take here. So many times it boils down to either, number one, they don't vote, or number two, they have no idea who they're voting for. And that's some of the most powerful change, and we got complete control over that, but we just don't take it.
It's a freedom that we cherish.
Yes.
And
a lot of folks died over it.
A lot of folks died, probably a million died. You know, I'm humbled with that reality. Every week in Washington, when I meet one of our committed soldiers and who have been there, I go to Walter Reed and visit with them there. You know, they care. They're committed. And they appreciate and respect the freedom that we have, and they're out there defending it. Let's just, as citizens, get involved. Show your concern. Go vote when the time comes up, and be supportive of people mm-hmm. who share your policies. If you know, it's when you're out there and you're trying to do your job, you take a lot of flack and a lot of heat. But some of us are committed to do the right thing regardless. Stand with the folks that you believe in, and help them to be there for you. I, for one, I'm not changing what I'm thinking. We need greater freedom in this country for the individual, and no one's going to change that. But it sure means a lot when somebody comes up and says, buddy, I'm all behind you.
Yeah.
Congressman, thank you very much for your time. Linda, thank you. Jamie,
thank you.
We appreciate y'all coming.
Great being with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Congressman. Well,